So, hello and welcome to the first real devlog. As you can see, I have done some code cleanup. The practice code is in a different project. I can show that as well later. But this is my project now, and this is how I will manage the game states. First of all, this is my main application game class with a game state manager and a asset manager, and this is my game state manager. It just has the basic game states. The render method for screens, the default render method, has float delta and it has no update method, and I like to keep my update and my render separate, and I don't really need the delta value in the render method. That's why in the main render method I call update with delta, which I created myself, and then I clear the screen, and then I call the other render method that I did myself without the delta, and basically I didn't do much else. So the first thing that I want to create is a logger that will log everything that I do in the console and in a text file. So here's the speed coding part of the logger. At first I tried to use the Java util logger and create my own, but I thought that was way too complicated. That's why I went with the libgdx logger, which should be better for my libgdx application anyway. And yeah, I basically created my own logging manager, which would take a text that I give it and log that into the console, a log file, or into both, and do that with a timestamp and with a level like warning or error or something like that. And that would basically help me debug what went wrong, and that would help me in the long run if later down the road when the game is finished someone will play the game and then something unexpected happens, like, I don't know, the game crashes. Then I will have the logger that writes a log file which the players can send me so I could look into what went wrong. So there it is. Just to see what happens with the asset loader, I loaded these images in, and I wrote two load methods. I wanted to write two load methods. I have load with only an asset descriptor that will put one asset into the asset loading queue, and I have load with an entire array list which will put everything in the array list in the asset loader. And to see what will happen, I put these 11 images into one array list and then loaded the assets with this array list. While it is loading, it's showing purple, and if it's done loading it will switch to the game state, to the play state, and that state is black, and that's locked right here. So debug show for the loading screen, then info these textures are loaded, then for some reason resize is called twice every time a screen gets loaded, then hide is called because this gets hidden, then show is called, resize is called again, I don't know why it's called that often, pause because I quit, then hide, and then dispose for everything else that you have specified. And I've specified to dispose the current screen first and then the rest, and then it will say dispose successfully, and you see everything that's called debug will only show while debug is turned on. You will see it was purple for a very little amount of time because it loaded these 10 11 pictures in really, really fast. And then you can see debug show. That's my basic logger, and that's the basic play states all readied up. I have added this Trello page. I don't know if I showed this yet. Even if I showed it, I added way more things in the to-do list. And I want to tackle the basic world and gameplay today, but I don't remember how this worked, so yeah. Yeah, I tried coding a Box2D world and some Box2D stuff, but it has been a month since recording the first part of the video, so I forgot how to code and how to code this especially. But yeah, I managed to copy a lot of my old code from the practice project. The only thing that's rendering right now is a debug renderer, and I created some basic shapes. But yeah, you see that there's a lot of thinking time because I'm looking up my previous code and I'm thinking because I don't remember how to do this. Yeah, so now you see I create a variable that's called ppm, pixels per meter, and I put this to 100. That means 100 pixels equals 1 meter, or 1 pixel equals 1 centimeter. And I need that for Box2D because Box2D has a unit system, for example meters, and my screen has the unit system in pixels, and the standard units are 1 pixel equals 1 meter, and that's very, very large. Imagine a 20 by 20 pixel box is 20 by 20 meters big. That's so big. So we need to change the pixel per meter ratio, and you can see what happens if you multiply by the pixel per meters instead of dividing by it. Hey, look. Look, what's that? What is that? What? And it's gone. What? What? So yeah, I was creating shapes, just playing around with different sizes, and also trying to create a floor where the rectangle can stand on. So yeah, that's it. That is the basic shape. And after that, I played around with positions and sizes because I forgot that if you set the width of a rectangle to 1 meter, it would actually be 2 meters wide. So the width is actually half the width. I don't know why, but it's that way, and it took me a long time to figure that out. Then, really quickly, with weird positioning, I created a dirty box, which I fixed later in the video. So I've played around a bit with Box2D. I created a Box2D world, and I let myself play around with friction and restitution. So if I add friction, it slows down properly. So you see it now also, it slows down way more, and it also does these flips. I can turn off the flipping by setting the fixed rotation to true. And now it's has proper friction, so it decelerates properly, but it doesn't flip around. I also played around with restitution. Restitution is basically how bouncy it is, and this is a value between 0 and 1. You can place it even higher or even lower, and that makes sense in some cases. Restitution 1 is 100% restitution. That means if a ball falls from 1 meter height, it will jump up exactly 1 meter back, and that's a perfect restitution, perfect bounciness. You can make it even higher so that it jumps up higher than it originally was, so that it gains force, and you can make it lower to make it more realistic. And perfect restitution looks a bit like this. So you can see if I do this, jumps forever, because if it falls from here, it will fall down and jump up exactly to the same point again, because it has perfect restitution. If I put this to, let's say, 0.5 float, it would be a bit more realistic. It would be like a ball, like a football or something like this. So it would fall and then lose some force while jumping up again. And I played around with that. I set the fixed rotation to false, and I had a lot of fun just bouncing around this chamber. I had a lot of fun just bouncing around this in this chamber, just seeing what will happen, doing something like this, which looks pretty good. I did that in university as well, and a friend of mine asked if I could add a ball and a second player so that we could play against one another, and he said that would be a great idea for a football-like game or Rocket League-like game as well. So I did exactly that. Here's now one player, that's one player, then I can control the other player as well. I can control them both at the same time. And there's this ball, so we can both kick around this ball. This physics simulation looks so nice. What I did for a few hours in university was that I just started this, pressed a few buttons, and then watched what will happen. I just watched how it will bounce, and in very specific scenarios, this will even, the rectangles could even stop bouncing. Yeah, in the next video I will delete the ball and the second character, and I will start to create something playable out of this physics simulation. Now I will have a shoutout section where I tell you which tutorials I watched in the entire time learning this. Between this and last recording, a lot of time has passed, like at least a month. And in this month I watched so many tutorials, so many hours of just libgdx tutorials. I watched through many Box2D tutorials, Box2D Lite, Ashley, but I still don't really know how to use Ashley. Libgdx AI is on my list, which I will watch sometime in the future. General libgdx, Scene2D was really big the past couple of days. I can show you what my practice project looks like. My practice project has these five packages. The Luna package is what my main package looked like before. It was weird, but let's not think about that. This was the first test I did, which had a few good things but very many bad things. The foreign test was the first really good tutorial that I watched, but it didn't use anything from libgdx basically besides the core libgdx stuff. The Box2D tutorial was the first one which used Box2D, and this was very usable and playable. And Scene2D was a all around very very good tutorial. The Scene2D tutorial is the newest one. I can show that. So this is the project that I played around with Scene2D. That's the first project where I used the asset manager to make this loading screen. Then with Scene2D I made this very weird splash screen. And then these buttons, which are really nicely animated and which work both. Exit will just make the same thing as closing this. And play, welcome, click a button. This is entirely in Scene2D, this entire game. This is a puzzle game. You know this game, you have to move stuff. And this is an invalid move. And you need to have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 to 15 aligned that the hole is in the lower right corner. And if you did that, you would win. And this is completely finished. It was a great tutorial. I know much more about Scene2D because of this tutorial. All of the tutorials that I watched are linked in my Git repository right here. When you scroll down to the README, I complete the README and I wrote much stuff into here. What programs I used and what placeholder sprites I used, for example. And in acknowledgements in the tab here, you can see the German libgdx tutorial, the English libgdx tutorial for general purpose libgdx, for just the core libgdx without anything. Then the Box2D entire tutorial, I think it's the same person. And then many libgdx tutorials by another person, which I watched like almost every video on his channel. I can show you his channel. I have just linked his channel because I've watched a lot of videos, and almost every video that I haven't watched is on my watch list for the next weeks. He does Box2D stuff, Box2D Lite, Ashley, libgdx AI, general core libgdx, general logic, everything that you will need is like in here. And that's why I just linked his channel, because linking every single video would be way too much. Yeah, and as I will watch more tutorials, I will make this list grow. I may have watched more tutorials, but these are the tutorials that greatly impacted how I am working. Like, this playlist taught me everything about libgdx, and this is the entire reason why I started this project and not gave up or lost motivation. This is the entire reason why I really, really know how to use libgdx properly. This is the entire reason why I know how to use box2d. And this guy is the entire reason that I know like everything else besides these 2 points. He's the one who taught me cameras, who showed me more box2d stuff, who showed me scene2d, who will show me AI, box2d lights. It's just a lot. That's it for this dev vlog. I will see you in the next one. Which would lock every text I give it to loaded the assets with this array list. This gets hidden. One peaks one. Now I will have.